see each other. I mean, yeah.
That's very nice, yeah. Nice.
In his mind.
Oh, we're ready. Susan?
Yeah.
We're ready.
Uh-oh.
So, but now there's a little problem with Sheila, you know, because she goes to the kitchen to eat. So what are we going to do?
Well, she's got to eat.
Yeah.
Well, she's as quiet as possible.
Yes, shut up.
You want to put someone outside the door, not during the bell?
Yeah, have one. Maybe the woman can help, you know, make sure that she doesn't walk in by accident and do or something. Yeah. We can close those. Okay, so.
January 17th, 1997. The survivor is Susan Brunn. Her maiden name was Mendel. I'm interviewing her. My name is Anne Bernard in Flushing, New York, United States of America. The interview is taking place in English. Today is January 17th, 1997. I'm interviewing Susan Brunn. Her maiden name was Mendel. My name is Anne Bernard. The interview is taking place in Flushing, New York, in the United States of America. And the interview was taking place in English. Good morning.
Good morning.
Could you tell us your name, please?
Susan Brunn.
Would you spell it? Your last name?
B-R-U-N-N.
And what was your maiden name?
Susan Mendel.
Would you spell Mendel?
M-E-N-D-E-L.
Where were you born?
In Berlin.
In Germany?
In Germany.
What year were you born?
February 22nd, 1923.
How old are you?
I'm 73 years old for another month.
What was your father's name?
Ernst.
And your mother's?
Helen.
Could you tell us what your father did for a living?
My father was an actor.
Was he in a special company in Berlin?
No, he wasn't in, I don't know, he was not in Berlin, I think. He comes from a town called Stettin, but I really don't know where he worked or how long he worked. He was very young when he died.
How old was he when he died?
I think 28 or 29.
What did he die from?
He was an officer in the German army in the First World War and sustained some wounds which never healed properly, and he died on the effect of those wounds in 1923.
How old were you at that time?
10 months.
And what happened to your mother after that?
Well, she, I don't know what do you mean by what happened. She lived and she was, of course, devastated and had to go on with her life and had to work.
What kind of a living did she have?
I'm not sure about the first few years. I was too little, I don't know. But she used to work at all kind of things. She was mainly a sales lady in dry goods stores, and then she opened her own store.
What kind of a store did she open?
Also dry goods, ladies' underwear and linen, that was all combined in Europe.
What was the name of the shop?
Wäschehaus Elegant.
Do you recall the street that it was on?
Not really. I think it was Müllerstraße. I'm not sure.
How successful was she in the shop?
Oh, she made a good living.
Who took care of you when she was in the shop?
I was, for the first, I don't know, when I was maybe one or two, I went to live with my aunt and uncle in Ratibor in Silesia. And when I was 9 or 10, I don't know exactly how old I was, when my mother got me back to Berlin, she put me in a home in about an hour out of Berlin, where she could come and visit me Sundays. And I was there until I was about 13, and then she took me home.
Could you tell us about some of your recollections about living with your aunt and uncle in Silesia?
Oh, that was wonderful. Whatever I remember, they were wealthy. They had a beautiful home. They had a big cigar factory, which came from my grandfather, actually. And I had a very good life.
What were their names?
Felix and Maria Fröhlich.
How were they related to your mother?
Felix was my mother's brother.
How many other children were in that family?
They had no children. That's why they would have liked to keep me always, but it didn't work out.
What are some of your memories of life in their home? Could you give us some details about that?
I have very, very little recollection about that. I just know that a very embarrassing moment was when I had my first day of school. I was driven to school with a chauffeur. And I felt at that time very embarrassed. And I know that they had one or two cars at all times, and I was driven around, and I had a very, very comfortable, nice life. I had a nanny who took care of me. I remember certain things, but I remember some stupid things.
Could you tell us what?
I remember that they went on a trip for a day or two to Czechoslovakia, which was very near. And I was used to go with them, and I wanted to go with them. But they put me to a cousin, I think to a cousin next door, a couple of doors away, and we had to play together and stay together. And I went in the balcony, and I wanted to throw myself down because they didn't take me along. This I see in front of me. It's funny that some things stick with you all your life.
What kind of religion did they practice?
Jewish. They were Jews. My aunt was not Jewish. My aunt was Catholic, but she was a better Jew than many Jews themselves.
Could you tell us about what that first few years in school were like for you in Silesia?
I don't remember anything about that. I just know I went to school there. Mm-hmm.
Do you remember the school?
Pardon me?
Do you remember the school?
No. No.
Did you celebrate certain holidays with the Fröhlichs?
They celebrated every holiday, a Jewish one and a non-Jewish one.
Could you tell us some of those experiences?
I don't have any recollection. I just know that there was another brother living in Ratibor, which was the younger brother of my Uncle Felix. And they were extremely Jewish, and they were Zionists. And all the Jewish holidays were celebrated in their house. And I remember when we were there, each of us had a menorah and had on Hanukkah to light the candles. And there were two children, my cousin Maya and my cousin Erwin. They live now in Israel.
Did you celebrate Christmas?
I think my aunt did. But they never had a tree or anything like that.
Could you tell us when you went back to live with your mother, what that was like?
When I went to the home or when I went to live with her?
Both.
Well, the home I didn't like. It was, I disliked living there. I didn't like it. And when I came home to my mother, I was happier. But I don't really remember much how it was. I just know that we always stuck together then, and we lived together from then on all the time, even in my part of my married life and my first marriage. And it was nothing extraordinary. It was just living. I don't know. I don't remember very much, probably because it wasn't so very interesting or whatever. I don't know.
What kind of an orphanage was it that you went to?
It was a Jewish, from some kind of a Jewish organization. And it had either children there who had only one parent or no parents at all.
What didn't you like about it?
Anything. The first few months were bearable because there were very nice people who were in charge. And I remember even their name. We called them Tante Ida and Uncle Arnie. They ran the place. And after a short while, they either emigrated or left, I don't know, and there came a woman who ran the place. A very prudish elderly lady. I see her in front of me, but I don't know her name.
How old were you when you were in the orphanage?
I must have been about 8 or 9 years old. I'm not sure. Nine.
Did you go to school in the orphanage?
Oh, yes. And to a regular public school.
What was the language that you spoke in the orphanage?
Oh, German.
Did you learn any other languages?
We started learning in school, English and French.
When you went to see your mother and stayed with her, could you tell us what kind of relationship you had with your mother?
A very good one. I was so glad to be home again.
What kind of a school did you go to then?
Also to public school. Never into a private school, if that's what you mean.
What was Berlin like in those years, as you can recall?
From what I hear from all people, and what I could see, as little as I could see, it was a very thriving and very international city. It had lots of culture. And it was nice. But it turned sour when Hitler really started all the... It wasn't nice anymore.
Do you remember the neighborhood that you lived in with your mother?
Yes. It was in the neighborhood of the Bayerischer Platz, I think. We moved around quite a bit. I don't know for what reason. But we did. I remember 1, 2, 3 different places.
What were they like?
Ordinary apartments. And at one point, the last one, my mother had to... The rents were very expensive and she didn't have the income like that anymore, so she rented out 2 or 3 rooms. Besides, it was also a fact that Jews were not allowed to have an apartment for themselves. They had to share.
What was your first recollection of anti-Semitism?
I think it was in school from one of my teachers. I don't remember, but I think that was it. It was a known fact. I mean, it was forced anti-Semitism. It was told. People have been told the Jews are this and the Jews are that, and you were not so much aware of being different in the beginning. You were much more assimilated, and suddenly you were a different person.
So what happened in school?
It was only that one teacher. All the others were pretty nice. And especially our principal was a very nice man, and I was at a point, I think, the last Jewish girl in school, and he always tried to keep me in. He said, I remember once he said to me, Mendel, I want you to finish. I want you to be able to have an education. And I will try not to report. They had to report. And I will try not to report as long as I can possibly do it. That's all what I remember. And I remember his name was Dr. Michaelis.
Why were you the last Jewish person or child in the school?
I don't know. I think that we did not emigrate, that a lot of my friends and our acquaintances did emigrate. And I would love to go out, and I told my mother I would like to get out of Germany too, and she always said, nothing will happen to us. Your father was an officer in the German army, and I'm considered a war widow, and nothing will happen to us. And when it was really happening, it was too late. She had no connection to get out. She tried everything. I know she paid money for a visa to Cuba, and this didn't work. And then she tried to go to Chile, and nothing, it was too late.
What was the information that you were getting in Berlin about what was happening to the Jews?
Well, we were all frightened. We saw that it's not getting better, it's getting worse, and we were forced to work in forced labor fields, in factories, and in all kind of institutions with very little or very, very little pay. And then little by little it got every day worse. You had to wear the star, and you had to, we're not allowed to sit on this bench or do this. We're not allowed to use subways or trams. If you lived in a certain mileage from your job, you got a pass that you could use the subway or the bus at certain hours, otherwise you had to walk. And that's actually all I remember. Everybody knows it got worse and worse, and then we were replaced, even in the factories, by Russian and Polish prisoners of war. And they didn't need us anymore. And
before we continue with that, I'd like to go back and ask you about what you did to entertain yourself as a young girl in Berlin.
To entertain myself? We had friends. And we met, you mean after when the Nazis started in 1933?
When you were a youngster, when you were living with your mother.
Well, that was already after 1933. So we had friends, and we stuck together. We had a fairly normal life until 1937, 38, We went swimming and we went to the beach. And we went and visited each other and we had little home parties.
Where was the beach?
Berlin is a city with lots of water. There was Wannsee, the little Wannsee, the big Wannsee, a lot of beaches.
Were you still in school in 1933?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
Did you go to the theater in Berlin?
I don't recall. I remember once that I went to a theater to saw him, and I saw Hansel and Gretel. At, I think at the Kolloper, some kind of opera.
Did you read any Jewish newspapers or German newspapers?
We had like a daily German newspaper. I don't even recall what kind of papers we had. I was too young for that. I don't remember.
Did your mother talk about what was going on?
Very limited, very little.
How did you get a feeling that things were getting worse?
By seeing it, by experiencing it.
What did you see?
Well, that we were then forbidden to go into a movie, we were forbidden to go to the beach, we were forbidden to do almost anything.
And how
we were singled out.
How did you find out that you were forbidden to go to the beach and to go to the movies?
Oh, there were announcements. They were in the papers and over the radio, and there must have been a Jewish paper where all the laws were printed.
Did anyone you know try to defy the laws?
Not that I was aware of. I mean, that in the beginning it was possible because you didn't have to wear the Star of David, so you took a chance to use a subway or to do this, or you know, you didn't get caught immediately all the time. But once you, I don't even remember when that was, I think that was 1940 or 41 when you had to start wearing the yellow star. And even then, some people didn't sew it on the coat. They put it on with a certain way that you could take it off and put it on and try to, you know, go a little bit against the law.
And what did you do about that?
I did that too.
When did you wear it? And when did you not?
90% of the time, only when I wanted to sneak into a movie or meet my friends at a certain place where we were not allowed. We did it, or we wore our handbag like this that you didn't see it. I really don't remember everything about that. Because it's somehow that you don't want to keep that, you don't want to think about it.
How was Judaism practiced in your home at that time?
If you mean if we lit candles on Friday, no, we did not. My mother did not do that because she felt she's alone and there's no husband. I don't know why, but it wasn't done, except that in the home where I was, we did it all the time. And in the house by my aunt and uncle, we did it.
How did your mother practice following the Sabbath and the holidays?
She knew it was a holiday and she went occasionally to a temple on the high holidays, but that was about it.
Did you go with her?
Yeah.
Could you tell us what some things about some of your friends and what happened to them?
I would say that 80% of my friends got killed in the Holocaust, and the other 20% immigrated to Israel, to South America, and to here. I have a friend still here in the United States, in New York. And I have one girl I'm very friendly with. I still correspond with her. She's a Gentile girl in Berlin.
When did you first meet Klaus?
In 1942. Oh, was it 41? At the end of 41? I don't remember. Could be in the beginning of 42.
Before you met him, had you stopped school?
Yes.
What grade did you go to?
I have to figure it out. I don't know anybody. Into school. I stopped school in 38. So I was 15 years old. In the first or second year of it was different in Germany. It was considered already Lyceum. They don't have that here. What is that called here? Not high school. It's already higher than high school. I don't know what it's called.
What subjects were you learning?
Everything in general, and whatever you're being taught in school, plus languages. English and French was the language we had to learn.
Did you have a favorite subject?
The funny thing is, when I went to Hebrew school, I liked biblical history. And I liked history altogether in Greek mythology. I liked. I was never crazy about arithmetic, and French was awful. English I picked up well.
Why did you stop school at 15?
Because I had to. I was thrown out.
Then what happened?
Was that 15? 38? 23, yeah. Then I had to... What did I do, actually? Nothing. Oh, yes. I tried to learn a trade. I went to a school and learned manicuring, and because we always thought we might emigrate. And that didn't work out. I wanted to become a cosmetician, and I had an interview with the offices of Elizabeth Arden, and they were not allowed to employ me because I was Jewish. And then I went through somebody, to a friend of ours, I don't remember, to somebody who taught me to become a seamstress, to learn sewing.
Thank you. We'll pick up on the next tape.
Okay.
Tape two, the survivor is Susan Brunn. What happened after you were rejected by Elizabeth Arden? What did you do?
I went to a school, some kind of a beauty school, to learn to become a beautician, mainly to become a manicurist, in hopes of establishing something, to have a job, to have a trade when I immigrate, which was up in the air, but I know we tried to.
Who paid for your schooling?
Who paid for my schooling? Schooling was at that time, I think, free in Germany. And I think the high school was my mother paid for. If there was a charge, I don't know. I think schools were free to a certain point.
This is in 1938. Could you describe where you lived?
We always lived in an apartment. We had an apartment, I think, in the neighborhood of Nürnberger Platz, which was in a very nice neighborhood, the west of Berlin, on a street called Achenbachstraße. We had, I think, normal, very nice apartment.
How tall was the building where the apartment was?
It was maybe a six-story building. We had the ground floor apartment. Towards the back, we had even a little balcony which went out into a backyard.
How many rooms were there?
Oh, I don't remember. One, two, three. I think four and a half. But my mother had always rented two. I had the half room, and the kitchen didn't count as a room in Europe.
Did the building have indoor plumbing?
Oh, yes.
What about electricity?
Everything. Every comfort was there. Electricity, plumbing, everything.
Did you have any favorite radio programs that you used to listen to?
I liked the American jazz, not the rock, the nice, like what they play in the 40s, this type of music. Music from shows. And I remember my mother had an old gramophone with such a big horn in which you had to wind up, and she had certain kind of records which we played. There was no television and all those things, so you kept entertained with that, and you played checkers at night or domino.
Who were some of your favorite musicians that you would listen to, or singers?
Oh, I was very into classical music, and I remember my mother went away for a week or so in vacation with a friend, and she left me money to eat. And I didn't. I bought myself a ticket to the Berliner Philharmonie to hear Claudio Arrau in a Chopin piano recital. From my earliest days on, I remember that I loved classical music, certain classical music.
What year was this?
Must have been 1938.
What happened after you went to cosmetic school?
I remember I was employed doing something completely different for about a couple of months, 3 months, 4 months, in a brokerage by a broker. I had to do the filing and It was already, he was already before his immigration. And I knew the job wasn't for a long time, and he knew it wasn't for a long time. It was just to help him get order in all his papers, and then he left. I don't know, 3, 4, 5 months.
So how did you make a living after that?
I didn't. I don't know. My mother had to make a little living for both of us.
What was the next thing that happened in your life?
The next thing that happened in my life was that I was... I forgot a big part. I had plans to go to Israel, Palestine that time. And I went for a year and a quarter to Hakshara. Did you ever hear that before? That's right, I forgot that. And I was in a place in Silesia called Elgut. And there I learned to become a farmer. And I was there for over a year, until the beginning and middle of 39.
How did you enjoy that?
I liked it. Maybe because of the comradeship, and it was very nice. I enjoyed it.
Why did it end?
It ended because my time was finished. You had to go so and so long to graduate. 3 months in the cow, what do you call that? In the kitchen 3 months, and 3 months you took care of the cows, and 3 months you took care of the chickens, or what? I don't know exactly anymore, but that's what it was. You had a certain schedule to learn everything, to go into a kibbutz in Israel. But that didn't work out anymore.
Why was that?
Because it stopped. There were no boats anymore going. And at a certain point, the danger for men, they thought, was greater than for women. And on the last few boats, they only took men.
How did you feel about that?
Not very happy, but I could understand it. Not knowing at that time that men and women, there was no difference, they were both in the same danger. But at that time they thought men are more dangerous, because at the Kristallnacht they took the men and not the women.
Were you a witness to a Kristallnacht?
Yes.
Could you tell us about that?
Well, we woke up that morning, and across the street from us was a Jewish tailor shop. And we heard that they banged in the glass windows and screamed, and I don't know, somehow we must have been warned, because a good friend of ours, a man and his son, came to our house, and we were hiding them, because in our house we were only women. My mother and I, we were registered. So they didn't come to the house to pick up men. They knew it's only the two of us. And we were hiding two men until the action was over.
How did you check out what had happened on the streets?
Well, you could see everything from the window and from, and then of course the radio and the newspapers. Spontaneous action, it said, but it wasn't spontaneous action.
Did your mother increase her efforts to try to leave?
Yes. I remember she was in touch with a cousin who went to Chile and tried that he should get her a visa, but nothing worked out. It was too late.
So what happened after this?
After this, we were both put into forced labor. My mother worked for a company which was called Deutsche Benzinuhren, and I worked for Siemens. And we lived like this as long as we could.
What did you do for Siemens?
I was a welder. I was welding little, like field telephones.
How did you learn how to weld?
They taught me.
Who ran Siemens?
I don't know. This was a big company. And there were different departments and different foremen. And it was a very big place. And there were lots of Jews there working.
Who was your supervisor at Siemens?
You told me to think about that, and I thought about it, and his name was Herr Gericke. I see him in front of me running in his gray, was like a long robe. And he happened to be very nice and very compassionate. He saw to it that I got every week, I think a quarter or half a liter milk, because I was inhaling the fumes, and Jews were actually not supposed to get it, but I got it. And he was very nice, and like he would ask me, we had one day a month, we could get a day off for laundry, and he asked me if I had that day already, and I said no. He said, tomorrow you stay home. He tried to be as nice as he was allowed to under the circumstances, as I remember.
Was he a Nazi?
Deep down, I don't think he was a Nazi, but he had to belong to the Partei. And he had to wear this little thing here. Everybody had to, more or less. And there were very few who didn't.
What was the little thing?
It was a pin with the sign of the Partei of the SR.
How long were you at Siemens?
Until 1942. In December of 1942, we went underground, and that's when I didn't go to work anymore.
Why did you decide to go underground?
I don't know if you found this out in your interviews. At that point, people got a list still. You will be picked up to go to be relocated, and you will be taken so and so. And my mother had, as I told you, always had a room rented. And there was a man living with us in the house, and he got the list and he was picked up. And when one of a household was picked up and got the list, we knew that the others would follow very soon. It was always in concession, one after the other. And so we decided we don't want to. We will go underground and try our luck. And we had the opportunity, because we had quite a few Gentile friends, and my uncle who lived in Berlin was married to a Gentile lady, this Uncle Felix, and my mother went to them for the first few days or weeks, and I went to other friends.
Who did you go to?
I went to Maya. Their name was Maya. I don't know, his Ludwig and Teresa Meyer. And he was also Jewish and she was Gentile. And for that reason they were not treated right away the way we were. As long as they were. I think even until the end, if they stayed together, they had to go to a working camp or something, but they could live. They were not killed. They were not deported.
What did you do while you were staying with them?
Nothing. I helped them in the house. And I couldn't go out. I was there and helped them. Occasionally at dark, and in the evening I went out for half an hour for a walk to have some fresh air. We had no ration cards, we had nothing though. They had to share what they had with us.
What was the food like that you were eating at that time?
Whatever you got on stamps, what they got, which was stretched, you got like 2 pounds of meat for the week per person, and you got 1/2 pound of butter, and you got 5 pounds of potatoes. It was all rationed. Not so much in the beginning, as it got always worse later on. I don't remember when we got ration cards, which year that was. We still, it must have been before, because we had some before which were printed with a J, Jew. And we could only get certain things on there. For instance, vegetables we didn't get. We only got one vegetable, and that's why I wouldn't touch it today anymore. Turnips, the big yellow turnips. And we had to eat that for years as our vegetable. And my husband loves it, and he wants it, and I'm not going to cook it. So he has to buy it ready cooked, and when I heat it up like that.
When did you meet Klaus at this point?
I met Klaus very early in 42, or even at the end of 41.
Who were you in hiding with at that time when you met Klaus?
I wasn't in hiding then at all. I met him when I still lived normal in an apartment with my mother. And this friend, she, Ursula Redlich, was living with us at that time. And he was introduced to me from a mutual friend.
What was his full name?
His full name? Klaus Hans Wertheim.
What was special about him?
No, nothing. Nothing was special about him. He was a nice young man.
And how did the friendship change? What happened to your friendship with him?
Oh, we were very good friends, and when the point came by the end of 1942, he helped me with getting out of the apartment. I remember that he came with a car and took whatever we wanted to take and helped us to put it wherever we wanted it to my mother's brother. I remember he took a big bag with potatoes. I see that in front of me. And our valuables and our clothes, the furniture, everything we left in the apartment. We only took a few oriental small carpets, which we all things which we hoped we will be able to sell.
Was Klaus Jewish?
No. Klaus had a Jewish father and a Gentile mother, and he was brought up Protestant. But he had only Jewish friends and was against Hitler.
How did he help you go into hiding?
Oh. Well, he helped me find at times suitable places to stay. He got me this place through his mother, with this man who we all called Papi Kolmorgen. That was his name, Mr. Kolmorgen. We all called him Papi Kolmorgen. He was like a father to 6, 7, 8 Jews. I don't know how many anymore he had up there in hiding. He helped me with food. And then I went to live in his place.
Where did you go after you left the Myers?
I tell you very honestly, I went to so many places that I don't remember anymore, from where to where. I had a friend, Victoria, I don't know where she brought me somewhere where people left for vacation, and she got the apartment for 2 weeks, or I was in so many places that I can't even keep track.
How many would you estimate that you were in?
12, 15, 16 different places.
Over what period of time?
From December 42 till the end of the war.
And how did you get from one place to another? How did you hear of each place?
By telephone, or by talking to the people, saying, I don't have a place to stay for tomorrow. Can I come to you for a couple of nights? By having lots of Gentile friends.
Why do you think the German Gentiles opened their homes to you?
Because they were firstly friends, and secondly, these were all people who were anti-Nazis and who wanted to help as much as they could.
Would you estimate that there was a big group of them in Berlin?
I don't know how big the group was, but there were quite a few people who were living underground with somebody like I did. And there must have been quite a number of people who helped at one point or another. There were also some which didn't know, which gave shelter to somebody who wanted to make maybe a little money, who said, like, I lived with my husband, with Klaus, together in a hotel, where we said we just got bombed out in Lübeck, I think, and we have to rent a hotel room for 2 weeks. And I don't even, oh yeah, he registered under his name, Mr. and Mrs. He had papers. I didn't. So there were all kinds of people who, but I would say 90% of the people who helped wanted to.
Do you recall what your state of mind was at this time?
Frightened. At times I felt I can't go through that anymore. I want to get it over with already, because I had the feeling I will be caught anyway. But then there was something in me, and I said, I'll try another day and another day. And it worked.
How was your mother dealing with this?
I think my mother had more courage at times than I did. Because I see her, she was in a different place. And I was in a different place, and she got from somebody a chicken or something, and she cooked it wherever she was, and she had a pot, and she came to the place where I was, bringing me a piece that I should have something to. So she dealt quite well with it.
She was
a strong woman.
How did you communicate with her to find out where
she
was?
Mostly by telephone. We always were able either to telephone direct or through, like this Mrs. Meyer. She was like our centrally, we called her and she gave the message, and my mother called her, and we always knew of each other where we are, and we met at times.
Tell us about your relationship with Klaus.
Well, there wasn't, it didn't take too long when you lived together. You know, we fell in love, and he helped me as much as he could, and we lived together. And when he was, suddenly it went also in a certain way against the Gentile Mischlinge, half the half and half people. And he was put to, it was called Organisation Tod. And he was a mechanic, and he was put into a place in Erfurt to repair underground a certain, I don't know what it was. They put the important places underground so that they couldn't be bombed. And these people had to go and do the work, the repair, and the, and since he was a mechanic, he was put there. There were people who had no trade, no, they didn't learn anything. They took them to clear minefields. That's what I heard. I mean, I haven't seen it, and I don't know, but that's what was said. And he got me a room in Erfurt, in a place where he told a cock and bull story about who I am, and that he is, everybody knew that he is a Mischling, otherwise he wouldn't have been there, and that I'm Gentile, and that we have, that we applied for permission to get married. That you could try, you were allowed to do that. But it took usually months and months and even years, and it never came through, but you were at least legal.
What kind of papers did you have?
I bought false papers, which I don't even remember, it was a Arbeits, when you worked, you had, like you work here for a defense factory, you had a certain pass. It was a paper like that from a job. And with the name of Susanne Martin, they told me it's always good to take, if possible, keep the first name and take the second name with the same initial like your real name, so that in case you would otherwise make a mistake that you don't do it. And as I found out, they were not too good, but they held up a couple of times.
How?
I was once caught on a bus. Not me, I wasn't caught. I mean, there was a checkup of everybody, and they accepted my paper.
Thank you. We'll pick up on the next tape.
Okay.
Tape 3, the survivor is Susan Brunn. Let's pick up on having you tell us about when you got pregnant.
When I got pregnant, it was no time to be pregnant, and we tried to eliminate my pregnancy, which somehow didn't work. And we took a family doctor, the family doctor of my husband's family, into. We talked to him. He was very, very anti-Nazi always. And it was a Dr. König. And he examined me, and he said he would come to the house and he would help me deliver the baby. As it turned out, about a few months, 3 months or so before, I don't know exactly how long before, he said to me, it will not be possible, the baby is not lying in a perfect position and it will be all kinds, and I have to try to go into a hospital. And there was a route, I remember, to go to Yugoslavia, to one of the other countries, and they wanted to get me out of Germany for the duration of the birth and all. But also that didn't work out. So my husband had the bright idea to talk to a friend of his, who was also like him, a Mischling, and try to get his sister to give me her papers that I could go under her name to a hospital because she was legal. She was married to another Mischling and they lived legal. And as he talked to him, it turned out that he said, no, it can't be done because his sister just had a baby and she can't have 3 months later another one. So, this friend of his name was Hans, had a girlfriend, very nice girl, who was also very, very anti-Nazi, and he told her the story and took a chance. And this girl was happy to do something against Hitler. And she came with him to the place where we were living, where my husband and I were living, and offered her papers and her help to me. And my mother was there, I remember that, and she said to her, do you know what you're doing? Because you can get really into deep water with it, and when you have now a child out of wedlock, later on you meet somebody who wants to marry you, and this is always in your papers that you had a child. So she said, I don't care if he really loves me, I will explain the story to him, and then he will either marry me or not marry me. I want to do it. And she helped me. She gave me her papers and we became the best of friends. And I went to the hospital under her name and gave birth under her name. And that's how we survived.
What was her name?
Hella Möbis.
Would you spell that?
Hella is H-E-L-L-A. And her second name, Möbis, is M-O-E-B-E-S.
And your child's name?
Was at that time, she was born under the name Hannelore Möbis.
What was the hospital that you went to?
Was a very nice hospital in Dahlem, Berlin-Dahlem. It was called Waldfrieden.
What kind of a delivery did you have?
A very bad one. I was in labor for close to 2 days. And then I had to get an injection to speed up the delivery. And then I didn't have the afterbirth. The placenta was, I had to be operated. And I was quite sick. And the child was very little and very, I had not very much to eat, so no, the care wasn't there, the milk and whatever you had to have. She was like 5 pounds. So it was not incubator, but it was very little. And I found even a picture how she looked. Big head and very small body. And, unfortunately, I never found Hella anymore. After, of course, by the end of the war, we were still okay. But after the war, she disappeared. She married a Dutchman and went with him. I don't even know the name. And she went to Holland to live with him.
Where did you take the baby to live?
We took the baby home for one day. And then we took her to a Catholic home, to a, what do you call that? Where they had children with no parents or only one parent, and or where they wanted to get them out of Berlin because Berlin was bombed so badly. And she was brought there under the name Hannelore Möges. And I was a single mother who brought her there. And my mother came with me. She was the aunt. And there were Catholic sisters who ran that home. That's where she was brought to.
How long did she stay there?
She was brought there in January of 1944. And we picked her up in May 45.
How often did you go to see her?
As long as we could, every week, until Hella was caught through something else, and it wasn't safe anymore.
Did Klaus go with you to visit the baby?
Oh, yes. Klaus was my cousin.
Where did the money come from for the two of you to live in
Berlin?
From
Klaus.
How was that?
Klaus was wealthy. Klaus had real estate in Berlin, big apartment buildings, and the income alone from the buildings carried us very nicely.
What was your life like besides that with Klaus at that time?
Well, I was in hiding with him, and financially I had no worries. He got on the black market, he got food. Everything was available on the black market. I mean, it was hard at times. You had to know where to go, but he got it.
Like what kind of things did he get?
Everything. Meat, poultry, butter.
Could you share that with your mother?
Yes.
What kind of a life did you have with him socially at that time?
There was no social life. We were glad if we could be alone and left alone and afraid to go out too much. So we went once in a blue moon to a movie at night. But that was it.
What kind of a place did you live in?
He rented a very nice apartment under his name.
You remember the street?
Oh God, I knew it the other day. Ansbacher Straße.
In Berlin?
Ansbacher Straße, 56.
Was this in Berlin?
Yeah. also in a quite nice neighborhood.
Did you have any friends at that time in the neighborhood?
Not really. His friend Hannah Hagen, and I had another friend who was a Mischling. And that was it. We didn't keep much. You try to stay away from everybody as much as possible. And even your best friend, you wouldn't say where you lived.
Why is that?
You were afraid if they get caught and they were put to the question, whom else can you bring in? Then we let you stay here for another 6 months. For each person you bring in, you get a certain period for yourself that you don't get transported to Auschwitz or wherever. So then they would know where we are and they could finger us. Didn't tell anybody where you lived.
What were the evidences of war in Berlin at that time?
Oh, there were bombings almost weekly, daily at times, and I loved it. It was always a lot of confusion, and everybody was it was easier to get around because everybody was confused. The officers were not as strict with everything. There were times at that time that I went to a bombed out house. Let's say there was a bombing, an air raid, and the house was bombed during the night. And in the morning they had near that house set up a station for people who lived there to come and get, they lost everything, to get new ration cards. And of course I took my luck in my hands that somebody might say, oh, she's not in our house. But they were also preoccupied with themselves. They didn't pay any mind to anybody else. Everybody was standing in line and got a ration card. And so I got a ration card too.
How many?
Sometimes, not always.
How many ration cards were you able to collect?
Oh, I don't know, maybe once in a while, not always. But I was lucky at some times to be able to. So that helped us.
What happened when you knew that war was coming to an end? Where were you and what was that like?
Where were we? We were at a point, 44 in January. I think we were back in his mother's place, in Klaus's mother's place, because he had to give up the apartment. Well, that was the time when he had to go to Erfurt. And I went with him for a couple of months. And then I went to his mother's place with my mother together. She didn't have a place anymore, and I didn't have a place anymore. And she said, you come here. She lived outside of Berlin in a very beautiful neighborhood, in a big house. I mean, much bigger than mine, or even though it was only the small house from the bad times. And not many people around. So we stayed there for quite a while. And that's where we got caught.
Could you tell us about that?
Somebody must have fingered us. And we were by two agents. One day they came and just blocked the back door and the front door and picked us up, wanted to pick us up. And I was able, through some kind of trick, to get away, hoping that they would run after me and look for me. And in the meantime, my mother could be hidden by my mother-in-law. And it was like that. But my mother was breathing very heavy because she had asthma already at that time. And so they found her breathing behind the mangle in the basement. And they took her. And if I wouldn't have had a child, I would have maybe gone voluntary too. But my first consideration was to try to live for the baby.
Where did your mother go?
My mother was put to Oranienburger Straße, where the big temple is. That's where they had the headquarter. And everybody was brought there. And it was already in October 1944. So Auschwitz was already, I think, partly under siege. The Russians were near already, I think. And they sent him to camps within Germany. She was brought to Ravensbrück. And we stayed even in contact. She was allowed to get one letter a month, and she was allowed to write one letter a month. And she wrote to her sister-in-law, to my Tante Maria. And I wrote to her as if I'm Tante Maria, but with my handwriting, so she knew that I'm all right.
And what happened to you?
What happened to me is I had to disappear, of course, from my mother-in-law's house. And I went... When I ran away, I went to the basement. I asked for permission to put the stuff which I was doing into the place in the basement where she kept her groceries and all. And they let me because two doors were under control, not knowing that there was a third door from the basement going out into the garden. And that's where I escaped from. And instead of running out in the street and running away, I was in the next building in the bushes, hiding for a day and a half until everything was clear. They never went to that part because it was the headquarters of the Gestapo. They took the big house from the Wehrkamps, which had, I think, 63 rooms, and made it in the headquarters. And the little house was next to it. It was a former gardener's house. And so I was hiding there until the coast was clear. And then I ran to friends of my mother-in-law who knew about me. And they helped me from then on.
The friends of your mother-in-law, what religion were they?
They were Gentile. They were also Protestant.
Do you recall their name?
Yes. Erxleben, Mr. and Mrs. Erxleben, E-R-X-L-E-B-E-N.
And after you left their house, where did you go?
To another Gentile family who knew me before the war. And from there on to another place, after 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, we always shifted around.
And where did you next meet Klaus?
Well, we met more or less all the time. He came to where I was. They knew about him. Or we met at night time somewhere on the corner of so-and-so and went for a walk. We met all the time. and about when the fighting was directly in Berlin, he said to me, enough is enough, and we are going out to our country house in Glienicke, because I'm sure that the person who was living in that house has fled, and we're going to check it out. And he was in touch with a neighbor there to find out, and he found out that they had left. They left the old mother and the maid, but the husband and wife had disappeared. He was a high officer in the SS or in some kind of an organization. And so he went with me, and we took along a maid, which was many years ago working for us, for us. And she was a very good person, and she knew all those years about me. I was in her house too for a couple of weeks, even though she had only a one-room apartment. And we took her along outside of Berlin too, because we didn't want her in the bombings and the fighting. There were street fights. It was like, I can't explain it. It was like every house, when you see in the movies today in Korea or where it was, every house had to be taken. And
who was fighting with who?
The Russians with the Germans. The German soldiers didn't want to give up, or were forced not to give up. And you could see the most horrible things in the street. There were some German soldiers who didn't want to fight anymore. And they deserted, and they strung him up on a lamppost.
Why did that upset you?
Wouldn't that upset anybody? I don't know. It upset me a lot. And we went out of Berlin and to his house. And as we drove out, the first American soldiers entered the city. That was a moment I can never, never, never forget and describe to anybody. We had made it.
Describe it to us.
The feeling. We were liberated, and we saw the Americans coming in. They came in from the west, while the Russians came from the east. And we had to go out to the west, to the house. And that guy must have thought I'm a nut, because I ran over to them, and I hugged them, and I kissed them, and I screamed, and I cried. And that was it. And we realized that we were saved. That feeling you cannot describe, you can't. I don't think anybody could.
When you got to Glienicke, what did you do?
Well, I was a housewife in Glienicke after the war was over. I didn't do anything. In fact, I lived quite comfortable. My husband got me a housekeeper. And after we found my mother and the baby, and we were all united, we had quite a comfortable life. And we had very nice American and British friends. We had a neighbor, my husband, whom he knew as a little boy, who came back with the English army as a soldier. And through them we met a lot of people. We were invited to American parties and to British parties. We had a very nice life.
How long did you stay there?
We came to this country in 47, in March of 47.
Why did you decide to leave Germany?
Oh, I didn't. I couldn't look at the Germans. I just wanted to get out. I didn't feel happy there, and I wanted to get out.
How did Klaus feel about leaving Germany?
The same way. He also felt... he was a little more hesitant because his roots were there, and he hoped all his property and... But to this day, he said to me, I'm glad that you made me come over here. I mean, to this day, I haven't spoken to him in years, in the last 2 years, maybe.
What did he do for a living while you were still there?
Nothing. In the end, after the war, he didn't work for a while. He had enough income from his property.
When did you come to, specifically, when and where did you arrive in America?
We arrived here on March 13th, I think. March 13th or 14th, 1947.
And what did you do when you arrived here?
Well, what did I do? We were put into the... we came through the Hayas, and we were put into the building of the Hayas on Lafayette Street. And it didn't take long. It took about a week until we found an apartment together with another couple who was on the boat. A terrible apartment, but we took it. Was in the Bronx on Jerome Avenue on the fifth floor walk up, but it was ours. It was, we shared it. We couldn't afford the rent alone. And he looked for a job and I looked for a job. And I had a job within 3 days. Also saw a friend of mine who came here with a couple of boats before me. And she told me what to do and what not to do. And I worked in the garment center. I was working for Peter Pan Brasier's piecework. And he found a job as a machinist somewhere. Unfortunately, he could never hold a job. He changed 1 year, I think, 7 or 8 times. He was a very good worker, but very, very slow. And this is not for America. You got to be fast here. I don't know why, but you have to.
Why do you think he left Germany and gave up that kind of an income to come here and struggle?
Well, firstly, he didn't. At that point, he didn't want to be separated from me, and I said, I don't want to stay here. And secondly, he thought... the income is there and they can send it over all the time, which was possible for a while. We did. But then, when Berlin was divided, all his property was in the Russian zone. And it was taken away from him. In the meantime, he got it back. And the wall was broken down. But for years, he didn't get anything. But he wouldn't have gotten anything either if he would have stayed over there.
We'll pick up on the next tape. Thank you. Okay. Tape 4, the survivor is Susan Brunn. How long did you work for Peter Pan, Brassiers?
I think I worked there until 1947, 48, 49, yes. Mm-hmm. I had a summer job. I worked for them. I took off for 2 months, July and August. My mother had a very good friend from Berlin yet who had a hotel here in the Catskill Mountains. And she offered me a job during July and August, like the summer jobs in the mountains. And I could take my daughter along out of the city. I couldn't afford a camp. And so I took that job for the summer, and then I went back to Peter Pan. But they did that only for 3 years, and then they said, oh no. And I didn't want to give up the job.
What was the name of the hotel in the Catskills?
Hotel Hunter.
How old was your daughter at this point?
My daughter was January 44. 3 years, a little over 3 years.
Who took care of her when you were working at Peter Pan?
We had her in a daycare.
What else happened to you in your working career in this country?
What happened to me? I liked my job. I did very well. I made, at that time, for a woman, just arrived here, quite a good money since I worked piecework. And matter of fact, I have been told that a couple of times to work a little slower in order to keep the wages the way they are. But I was new and I wanted to make as much money as I could. We needed everything. And we even paid back to the hires the money for the trips from Germany to here for the boat. We paid that all back within maybe 6-8 months until we found out we shouldn't have. It was donation money and they were not supposed to ask back for it. But we had paid it back already.
What other kinds of working experiences did you have?
I did not work for anybody else. I always wanted to be on my own. And my mother had gotten remarried at that point. And we bought some money or something also. And we bought a little luncheonette, a little restaurant luncheonette in Washington Heights. And that's where we worked, my husband and I.
What was the name of the luncheonette?
Garden Luncheonette. It was very nice, except it was a former white tower. It was that white building with quite a big piece of property. What I didn't know was that the building belonged to this man we bought it from. But not the ground, not the... And one of these days, we had to get out. They said, you can take your building, but we need the ground. So I couldn't take the building on my head and go. So that's how we lost it. But it was very nice, and we made a living. Not a very big living, but a living. I had a very nice little garden in the back, which I fixed up the typical European style. Tables, little lanterns over it. And a lot of young kids came and they were the best customers. They drank at one evening, like each of them, 2-3 malteds or ice cream sodas. And they played the jukebox and they danced. I even have pictures of them yet. We were very good friends and it was good until we lost the place. What did I do then? I still had my job in the country. but at a different place, not at that place anymore, in another hotel. And I took my daughter along there for as long as I could. Only at the time when we had the luncheonette. And I didn't go to the summer job anymore. I put her into a camp. Very nice camp, which was at that point inexpensive and very nice. And then I didn't work anymore.
When did you get divorced?
In 1900. We separated in 1960. And my divorce became final in 1962 in June. And I got remarried in September of the same year.
And how did you meet your husband?
My husband was very funny. He was with his first wife, a customer of mine, in the hotel where I worked. But we had no connection. And we were invited. I was invited somewhere. And he was there. And we talked about that he just had learned in a school to go and play bridge. And I told him also, it was a party with many people, that I just learned to play bridge. So he said, how about playing bridge together once? So I said, fine, come on over one day. And I had another couple here, and we played bridge together. We were all beginners. And that's how it started.
How long have you been married to Kurt?
34 years and 3 months.
And what did you do with Kurt as a joint business?
We were in the home catering.
What kind of catering did you do?
Everything. From bat mitzvahs, bar mitzvahs, weddings, birthday parties, but only private. In homes, except I had one temple where I worked.
For how many years did you do that?
We retired in 1990, I think, 1990.
How many years were you in business?
About 28 years.
Has your experiences in any way affected the way you practice Judaism today?
Maybe. I'm more aware of being Jewish, of keeping holidays and being active in the Bnei Brits or maybe it has to do with that. I don't know. Maybe it has to do with that I married a man who is more involved.
Did your experiences affect in any way the way you raised your daughter?
I don't think so, no.
Where is your mother today?
My mother is living with us since 19, she lived with us when we got here, when we got to America, and in 1949, I think, she remarried. And her husband unfortunately passed away in 1956, I think. And from then on, she lived with us again.
How old is your mother?
My mother is going to be 99 in June.
Why did you decide to tell us your story today?
Because I feel if nobody would do it, then nobody would know about it in later years to come. And this is something which should never be forgotten, especially since there are people around who say that there was never a Holocaust. And this is an absolute lie. I have lost 80% of my relatives in the Holocaust.
Is there anything else you'd like to add to what we've already said today?
I don't think so. I don't know what. I'm just happy that it's over, that we made it, that we are alive, and that we're in this country. Nothing is 100% perfect, nowhere, but I still think it's the best country to be in. When we go on vacation on a trip, we're always happy to come back home.
Where does your daughter live today?
My daughter lives in Arizona.
You have grandchildren?
Yes. Combined with my husband, we have four. But on my own, my blood relations are two.
How old are they?
Julie is 29 and Scott is 26.
Thank you very much for sharing this day with us.
Very welcome. I did it with pleasure. This is my grandmother and grandfather, the parents of my mother. And their name is Israel and Bertha Fröhlich.
And the picture was taken?
The picture must have been taken around the 1900s, 1895, 1900, something like that.
In Germany?
In Germany, in Ratibor, yeah. This is my mother and my father. Their name is Helen and Ernst Mendel. And the picture must have been taken somewhere around 1922 in Berlin. And my father was a very nice looking man and he was an actor. This is my father, Ernst Mendel, while he was an officer in the German army in the war of 1914 to 1918. He was, this picture must have been taken somewhere around before 1918 when he became a prisoner of the British and he was in a prison camp on French soil. This is a picture of myself which was taken at about age 4 or 5, I don't know exactly how old I was there, and I was living at that time in Ratibor, Silesia.
Why were you living there?
I was living with my aunt and uncle. This is a picture of myself at the age of maybe 16. And that was, of course, during the Hitler time in Berlin. This is a picture of an uncle of my husband and myself right after we got officially married in 1945 and who presented us at this time with a beautiful big fresh fruit basket, which was very hard to get by, but he somehow got it.
What year was this?
Oh, that was taken in 1945.
What was the name of the uncle?
I only remember his first name, Uncle Emil. This is my husband, Klaus Wertheim, and our little girl and myself in December of 1946 in Berlin, on the main street, Kurfürstendamm, which was taken by a street photographer. This is a picture of our daughter, Sylvia, who was at that time 2 years old, and that picture was taken in the house where we lived at that time, in Glienicke. And the carriage I got from a friend of my mother, and I bought it for 10 pounds of potatoes. Okay, this is my grandson, Scott Zimmerman, who is at this moment a captain in the American Army, and he is stationed in Bosnia, in Tuzla. And I hope he's going to come home soon. And this picture was taken in Europe in 1996. This is a family picture of the five generations of our family. From right to left is my husband, Kurt. Then it's me. Then comes my daughter, Sylvia. Then comes my granddaughter, Julie, holding her newborn baby. Then is my mother. And at the end is Julie's husband, Scott. And it was taken on the occasion of the first visit of the baby to our house when the baby was 1 week old.
So this is.
And it was taken in the first week of December 1996.
So this new baby is your great grand.
No? Okay. This is my husband, Kurt. We are married 34 years and 3 months, and it has been a very nice, good time together. And I wouldn't change it a bit.
I'm Kurt Brunn, and I really appreciate to have such a good wife after I went through so much my first marriage. And what she went through in life, I just, it's impossible to describe. But it's. I'm amazed that she's still. That she's still fine there like that. I have to say. And we love our children, and she loves my children, and we hope we can continue many more years. And one thing for sure is that we both have compassion and feel for Grandma, and want to go through life many, many more years.
Thank you very much for sharing this with us today.
I wasn't prepared, mate.